all across this country, Europe, Canada, there are former cult members who can work with parents and relatives and fill them in on cults in general, and with time, families can, through cult awareness network and other cult information providing groups, learn how to contact former members of certain groups that will be available, and can talk with them of how to contact, what to write, what to say to the persons that are still back in the cult, to be of the maximum help of taking any opportunity that the cultist shows of wanting to talk about whether they want to leave or not. In working with families and friends of people who are in cults, those of us that counsel with relatives, point out to them how to become very aware of any cues that the person wants out, wants time away, is having their doubts. And not to badmouth the cult and say, you were an idiot for joining that group, come on out. To say to them things such as, look, anytime you want to come home, we'll pick you up, we'll send you a ticket, and you can have our cabin in the country, or, you know, you can go to your Uncle Joe's. But to let the person know that they sense that they might want out and that the family will help. And no matter how poor families have been that I've worked with, they have gone around and found relatives that would be of some help to aid the relative that's back in the cult. There are three categories of former cult members. There are walkaways. By far the greatest number of former cultists are ones who walk away at some point in time from the cult. They walk away from a matter of days, weeks, months to 25 or more years with the cult before they walk away. The second group are those who are exit counseled, in which the family and friends find ex-members or full-time exit counselors to meet and help the person make a quick transition from cult to the new outside world. And the third group of people who exit cults are called cast-offs or throwaways. And those are people that the cult turns on and throws out for one reason or another. Sometimes the person is thrown out because they become ill, either physically or mentally. The person becomes too old to really help enough. Sometimes they have become mentally ill and are psychotic or seriously depressed, and the cult just sends them away. So those are the three categories: walkaways, cast-offs, and the exit counsel. Most everyone has heard the terms deprogramming and exit counseling. Deprogramming is the older term that got into our language in the, you know, early 70s, when parents lost young adult children into the youth cults. They got desperate and would often go and grab them and take them to someone to talk over what had happened and so on. But as time has gone on, it's no longer the way that people help persons to exit from cults. And most of the cults, not just some, but most of them, put out a lot of propaganda that's based upon those desperate parents who long ago knew no other way and there was no other option, and they went and grabbed their kids off the street and had a deprogramming. And the way that term programming, deprogramming got in was this being the age of computers and so on, about 25 years or so ago. Parents and families couldn't think of how to describe to people how this missing member of their family now talked, and they said it seemed so programmed, meaning that when you asked them something, the cultists didn't carry on a two-way conversation. They sort of preached at you and spouted cult jargon at you and so on. And so in that early era of the modern-day cults, the parents began talking about and labeling the exiting process deprogramming. But it hasn't been called that all the time for quite a while. People still refer to it, but nobody is snatching people off the street that I'm aware of. And there are so many cult veterans and full-time ethical exit counselors that are available to help make exiting a cult a helpful, helpful experience. And there are a number of people around the U.S., Canada, and Europe now who pretty much work as full-time exit counselors. And what these people do is help families learn how to prepare to make a contact and at a moment when the cultist is willing to listen to ex-members and other people and how to word it. So there's a lot of parent preparation time or relative and family preparation time that the full-time exit counselors, almost all of whom are former cult members themselves. And what they've done is they have learned all about how thought reform processes work, how influence works. They know their experience from their own cult days. And then they present in detailed form information of videotapes, printed material, documents, their own testimony, that of other former members, to the cultist who's willing and interested in reconsidering whether he wants to stay with the cult or not. So that exit counseling, when properly set up and carried out, is a jointly agreed upon educational venture. It's been my observation and that of most individuals who work and counsel with ex-cultists that those who have been to exit counseling get their lives going the fastest and easiest compared to the walkaways or people who never meet exit counselors, because just learning how the influence worked and how their behavior was changed and how their thinking and emotions were changed and controlled is so helpful that it speeds up the reentry into mainstream life rapidly. If you're a walkaway and you don't have any way of contacting an exit counselor, at the end of this videotape, we're going to have the names of places that you can write and call and get information and even make contact with ex-members of the group that you were in who themselves were exit counseled, and they may be nearby, and if they aren't nearby, you can often talk with them on the phone to get some information and help that way. See, the word cult refers to the relationship between the followers and the leader, in which the leader is all powerful. And then the way the leaders, as we say in psychology, shape the behavior, make the person adopt the policies and attitudes, is done through a thought reform program. The programs that most cults and high control groups use can be grouped into two major effects. Thought reform programs that produce primarily dissociative states. These are the groups that engage in a lot of guided imagery, a lot of meditation. The second group of results tend to be cults that use techniques that produce high emotional arousal. And these are just explanatory ways because most cults use both dissociative techniques and high emotional arousal techniques as part of the thought reform program. I do a kind of psychoeducational counseling by teaching people what was it that your swami, your guru, your leader did that caused certain things that now that you've left the cult, and even while you were in the cult and may have led you to leaving, are kinds of behaviors and inner experiences that are really bothering you. So that many people watching this video, I'm sure, have all kinds of questions about some bodily and emotional and mental symptoms that they wish they knew how to fix. Because now that they're out of the group, they would like to be more efficient. And I've put the kinds of problems into about five major clusters. While many people have been in cults, medicine, dental care, mental health care, and education have been very denigrated and put down. And when people come out of those groups, they really have to put in a lot of time talking with people and getting comfortable about seeking medical, psychological, help, and even going back to school to get more education, because the cult so denigrated those things. So I group those as practical problems. A number of women who have been in cults where they have worked 19, 20, 21 hours a day, lived under extreme stress, eaten rather poor diets, and were told that they should be infantile and act like children. A number of these women apparently have stress responses, and their menstrual periods just stop from the whole pressure of the cult. And when they, you know, they will have been without menstrual cycles for a long time, and they'll come out and wonder what's going to happen. And I explain to them they really should see a doctor, but they should tell that doctor that they were in a certain cult and tell the doctor how stressful their life really was, in spite of the fact that while they were in, they looked happy, cheerful, productive. The stress probably turned off the menstruation. And of women that I followed for a period of years, all of them have eventually gotten back their menstrual cycles where it was this stress reaction. I've also worked with men whose beards stopped growing, very young men who went into the cults, one or another. And physicians have suggested that it too, like women losing their menstrual cycles, is a response to major enduring chronic stress while they're in the cult. next members leave family members back in a cult, one of the best things for them to do is reconnect with the rest of the family on the outside and themselves get embedded in the outside world and start recuperating their own skills, their own thinking, getting their feelings together before attempting to contact the people back in the cult. And sometimes it's absolutely impossible for them to safely go back and try to get a wife or child from the group, and that they really need to seek legal redress in how to appeal to court systems so that they can have custody arrangements arranged for through the courts, so that they learn to use the outside justice system to help them when people have left cults. They need to think exactly how to explain their time in the cult, because the popular prejudice is that only crazies and lunatics and weird people and stupid people get in cults. That's simply not true. But there's a prejudice in a number of people's minds that that's who gets in a cult. So that I tell former cultists, wait until you've established a pretty good connection with the person before you tell them, by the way, I was 10 years with a certain group, because the person needs to know you, and then you as the ex-cultist need to go ahead and take the time to explain to them how it all worked. Many people give up years of their life. Often women have been in cults so long that they've passed up the age of being able to have children. And when they come out, they rue and regret all those lost years. Not everything was bad, but many years when they could have chosen their own pathways, their own spirituality, their own psychology, their own jobs, could have had contact with their family and whoever they chose, all of those choices were controlled by the group. The cult often does what I call sort of hex people, telling them that they're sort of a walking time bomb, that if you ever leave the cult, you're going to get cancer, you're going to go crazy, you're going to be a bad person and rob banks, in which they make dire predictions. And many ex-cult members, for a while, are just terrified until they learn from other ex-members, from reading, from contact with lots of people in the outside world, that this was just a human making those dire predictions in order to intimidate and make them fearful. And so that they get comfortable learning that their cult leader was not omnipresent, omniscient, and all-powerful. Their cult leader was simply one other human being with feet of clay. While you were in the cult, that engaged in a lot of empty mind and guided imagery and past lives explorations, you learned that it didn't always feel good when you meditated, but you got in trouble and you couldn't stay with the group, you couldn't take advanced courses. You became a pariah if you let them know that you were suffering relaxation-induced anxiety, and when you're in, you don't know a name for it. But relaxation-induced anxiety is moments in which the person feels just panicked because they become aware in a very disconcerting way of their muscles twitching and changing. They become aware while they're trying to do their meditation of changes in temperature. And when they're not meditating, they find their mind just flooded with scary amounts of anger, sexual feelings being called forth with no clue at all from the environment, and feelings of just terror turning on. So these are the effects that are called relaxation-induced anxiety phenomenon that are outgrowths of certain long-term intense cultic practices. After coming out of cults, I've worked with people who said to me over and over again while I was in my cult, this person that worked with me on my past lives had me go over and over when I had been a violent man, when I had been a violent killer, when I tore heads off of babies, just the most gruesome things. Those are what are called pseudo-memories or confabulations, in which the event never happened, but the word power of the second person was organized in such a way as to get the person to create a false memory. And in cults, they come to think that, gee, that was their past life, and that they were these people that they have to name and deal with. And it has a really profound and relatively long-lasting impact on people. I would not recommend that ex-cult members that have been in the ordinary cult that uses a lot of trance induction, creation of false memories, pseudo-personalities, the last thing in the world I'm going to suggest to them is to go and get hypnotized to, quote, find the truth. All that's going to happen is they've been so trained to fall into a mode of going along with the program. They'll just dig up some more to please this guy. They need time away from that type of relationship to learn about how it was done, to learn how to just plain suppress it and accept that it was a creation of their memory and the human ability to create images by listening to other people's words. Often people say to me, I'm still dissociating. Do you think I'm losing my mind? I used to do this all the time in the cult, and they told me if I left, I'd go crazy. I explain to the former cultists that dissociation is a common, ordinary human mental mechanism or skill, and we all dissociate a little bit all the time. While you've been watching this videotape, there have been a number of times when you spaced out, because we all space out every once in a while. That's all dissociation is. When I'm talking to people that don't know what it is to feel dissociated, I say to the person, you're sitting here, and you know if you look at your finger, this is close range. Then there's middle range, and then there's long range gaze. And I say that if you really want to feel sort of dissociated, learn how to just sort of stare into mid-range and let go in some way. That's as close to creating what feeling dissociated is like. When the ex-cultist gets stuck in that spaced out feeling state, which was prized and promoted in the cult, and they can't get out of it, they think that's abnormal, they think it's a sign of mental illness, and they worry. And I teach people ways of getting out of those dissociated states. such simple things as saying to the person, think of yourself as if you're looking at three steps in a garden, and you're going to go one, two, three. When you get to the top, you're going to be fully room-level aware and awake, and you're not going to be dissociated. And I teach them simple little gimmicks like that, that they can call on to pull themselves out of the dissociated state. And they learn that dissociating and spacing out is a perfectly human event, and they overlearned how to dissociate while they were in the cult, either through the meditation techniques, the guided imagery, or other techniques. And when they come out, they don't have any gimmicks and devices for breaking up the spacing out. There are other very helpful, simple devices for getting yourself back to full room level awareness if you feel you've dissociated. Such a thing as just, you know, pinching your finger, pinching your hand, something you don't need to do a big display, but such a thing as just getting some other sensory modality turned on, like, you know, anything on the surface of the skin, closing your eyes, turning on the radio, anything where you get some input, or tell your friends, if I've spaced out, look at me and say, what are you thinking of? And then you'll say, oops, I had spaced out. And then you'll say to your friend, could you tell? And the friend will say, oh yeah, I can tell. There's just an absence about you. There's nothing wrong. But knowing you so well, you seem absent. It's suddenly feeling yourself as if you were back in the cult, and certain of the behaviors and attitudes that you displayed while you were in the cult, you find yourself displaying now. And you're very puzzled, and you don't know if you want to go back, or are you afraid of it, but it is such a peculiar experience that you feel you're sort of floating between two worlds, the one that you're in now and the one that you left. An area in which lots of ex-members have trouble is making decisions. And in counseling with the relatives, I say, even though your daughter's 32 and she's, you know, been in the cult all these years, she's as needy when she goes shopping now, because you don't want her to keep on wearing these robes that she's been wearing all these years in the cult, and she wants clothes like all the rest of us wear, you need to go with her because she hasn't been buying clothes all these years she's been in the group. And also, she's been so hammered down ego-wise that she doesn't know whether she looks good in pink or green. So when you go shopping, be of help. Remember, she hasn't had some practice for a long time. Even though she's brilliant and competent and was running a big multi-million dollar part of the cult, she needs your support in many of these simple daily living things. And you just go along and find out and, you know, don't infantilize them, but sure offer to go shopping. Offer to help them pick out whether they should get a green dress or a pink one. The cult jargon has the implication of innuendo, that something's meant that you understand. Because in the cult, all they had to say was call out a command, and you knew you were to do this, do that, act like this. But in the everyday outside world, I have to be more specific to know, do you really want to do that? Do you really want to eat this? And so there is the idea of innuendo rather than finding out what we're referring to, so that it's almost non-referential speech. And the other problem is that you talk in code. And it's so shortcut that you aren't sharing enough details with the listener that the two of you can make a sensible next step. So innuendo and sparse code, and people have a heck of a time if they keep on talking in cult jargon. After being in a cult, many people find it's very difficult to say no, because while they were in the cult, they had to obey all the time, and they come out and they find themselves going along with anybody's whims. I've had a number of young ladies tell me that while they were in the cult, they had to be so obedient that when they came out, guys that they didn't like at all would ask them out, and they would just go because they were so used to saying yes. And they would find themselves on the way to an event and saying, what am I doing here? I don't know this guy. I don't like him. Let me out. They had just automatically said yes. So learning to say no after years in the cult can be important. Ex-members often hesitate stating their real opinions about things because while they were in the group, they would have been ostracized and punished. But out here, people really want to know, what do you want, what do you like, where you have to make decisions. And part of adapting to the outside world is stating your opinions in a shareable way. Once outside the cult, it's best if the former cultist goes slowly in making new friends, because they were gullible enough and trusting enough that they followed some Pied Piper already for many years. So I suggest to the former cultist to be slow, not cold, but slow to make new friends, and not cold, but cautious in responding to new friends, so that they can really check out, do we have similar values, and to overcome that propensity to say yes and go along with anything, and to really learn to say, do I like this person for real? Do I really like this person? Do I like doing things with him or her? And get comfortable with your own likes and dislikes. You don't have to say them out loud, but you act on them. And if you meet somebody and you fall in love and you're going to get married, by that time you should have shared with them the details of your time in the cult so that they know why you have certain habits, why you have certain fears. And I've done a lot of counseling with people who have this problem. It's a normal problem of how to explain to a partner how a nice, bright person like you was with Brand X cult for all of these years. Because the new partner, new man friend, new woman friend, may have such a bewildering wrong idea about who gets in cults. And what they need to know is that you're an okay person and you just spent all this time with a group and now you're out and you're hooking up with the life you once had. Sometimes when former cult members go to see a clergyman who was the clergy person of their past, And they go to this man or woman and explain that while they were in the cult leader married them to another member of the group, and that they've left the group and that they're now divorced. And the clergy person is unable to really deal with the fact because he hasn't or she hasn't been aware that cults marry people to other members. And then when a person leaves, they will leave the spouse back there because they really didn't love or want the spouse. And it was put upon them by the cult leader. So that I hope with some of the clergy who are watching this video that they'll start thinking of the wide variety of things about cults they may need to learn so they do better counseling. I've done a fair amount of counseling with families who have come out as a group to help the parents deal with telling the children that certain behaviors simply have to stop because they were done only in the cult, that the parents had not done these behaviors before, and that they're not done in the outside world. And this particularly comes in children that have been in cults where the cult has promoted the women members going out and recruiting men members by prostitution means. And within the cult leaders encouraged parent-to-child sexual touching and sexual acts, and where the cult encouraged child-to-child sexual activities. I work with the families who emerge from these cults to tell their children that those activities were done only in the group, we're no longer in that group, so that you can't touch children in certain ways, you can't do certain things because that's done only back in the group, and that mother and dad didn't do that before, they're not going to do it out here in the world. One of the things that ex-cult members have to deal with is they're no longer world savers. They're no longer elitists. They've left this organization that really had pretenses and phony descriptions of what they were doing for the world. And they're no longer world savers. And they have to deal with that. And for some, it's very disenchanting. But they survive. And also, one of the things people have to work on after they come out of a cult is not being so critical of everybody. See, in the cult, you're fussed at if your clothing doesn't look right, if your hair is not right, if you use the wrong wording. You're forever being brought up to standards. And people get severely punished for the slightest little mistakes within cults. And when people come out, they're very critical of all of the rest of us who sometimes, you know, lose our appointment book or we can't find the car keys. That was a big deal in the cult. Sometimes in cults, people have been taught to hate certain groups. That is, they've been taught to dislike people of other religions, to dislike people of other nationalities, other races. They have had built-in learnings of prejudice that they have to cope with when they come out and live in a multicultural, multi-ethnic world. When a family has someone come home that's been in a cult, the first thing that family should do is really get a lot of material from the library about cults and start reading. Find out if there are other ex-cultists in the area. And there is a group called FOCUS, Former Cultists, all over the United States. And these are ex-cult members who get together to share their experiences of being in cults and closed groups and share their experiences of the problems in adapting outside, so that the ex-cultists are not basket cases. Some are, a few are really, really a mess when they come out of certain groups. But on the whole, after a period of time, people start regrouping themselves, getting going again, and if families will just give them a little leeway. One of the things that families have to learn is that the cults try to come and lure people back, and that the ex-cultist wants the family to have no contact. Don't answer the phone, don't answer the door, don't answer the mail from the cult. They want a break with them. And oftentimes, even though the person's been in the cult for a long time, I have to talk with the family and tell them, you must respect this person. He or she knows more about the group, and they know that for them it's best to do total severing, because the cult's just going to try to lure them back in through guilt to use them some more, not for their betterment. Often relatives say, I can't understand that my relative was under stress in the cult, because every time we ever saw her, she looked pretty happy, she was smiling, she talked with us, and she had such responsible jobs in the cult. What do you mean stress? And then I try to get the ex-member to tell what the stress was, of feeling you were going to mess up any moment, worrying when is the spaceship coming to pick us up, when is the transformation going to happen, or when will I lose all my status and be punished, so that it was not a peaceful inside the head time, even though outwardly it looked pretty normal. Because you don't see bands of cultists looking so worried that they look like mental cases. On the outside, they look fine. We have to learn from them when they're free to tell us what it really was like inside their head during that time. Sometimes the family becomes aware of this ultra-obedience, and I counsel them to start asking the recently exited cult member to make a choice between two things. Do you want cereal for breakfast or toast and egg? Don't say to them, what do you want for breakfast? Because they'll be busy looking to see what do you want them to want. But if you say, you can have either cereal or toast and bacon and eggs, which would you like? They get that practice of making the decision. And I also teach the family to say, maybe you don't even want breakfast. So that they teach them really early on that even with a two-part, either or question, that we can always in the outside world say, I don't want any breakfast, I don't want any supper. And that's very helpful to the families, because sometimes the families say, well, look, my son is 26, he's been in this group, he should just be able to do all these things on his own. I have to explain, look, your son went into this group when he was 16, he's been in there 10 years, he's like a very youthful, immature 16-year-old, even though he's been out on the streets and selling things for the cult, and doing all kinds of things for 10 years. he doesn't know how to do a lot of things, and you need to be of direct help by asking him, Ralph, do you know how to go and get a driver's license? Ralph, would you like me to take you to get your driver's license? You help by delineating what's here in reality to be dealt with. Let them choose, but you narrow down the options and you imply it's okay to even say, I can't make up my mind now, let's wait till later. But you have to put that in words for them. Because see, while they were in the cult, they couldn't say, I don't know what I want to do. They had to do what they were just told to do. Most members of cults are nice people, usually pretty altruistic, and they joined this group thinking they were going to better themselves and better the world. And they were surrounded for a number of years by some very dedicated, nice people who were in the same spot they were. And the relatives should really let people talk about some of these positive things, because the other members, they've had lots of warmth, like these people, were very close to them. I have known people that have been married to three different people while they were in the cult. First, the leader, you know, had them divorce the wife they brought in, then marry someone else. Then he took that wife, married them to someone else. And they had warmth and attachment to these people. And part of getting a normal life going is to be able to talk about some of the warmth, some of the goodness that they had. Families get worried thinking that if they allow the ex-cultist to say anything good about their time in the cult, it means that they want to go back to the cult. And it's no, they want to share with us, just like we don't tell Persian Gulf veterans, World War II veterans, Vietnam, Korean veterans to stop telling us about their time in the military, because we know even though war was hideous, they had buddies that they truly respected, they had commanders that they respected, they had fun moments, and they want to share part of their past. So let them share part of their past. All of us are sort of social creatures, and if we'd been in a cult 5, 10, 15, 20 years, like some people have, it's rather bleak to think you have to start all over again. And yet, people come out and they get going again. And it's marvelous to see the wonderful resiliency in humans. Humans who have been treated so badly while they were in the cult, and so put down, and really got such terrible self-images, and they come out and they're always so grateful that their family even will speak to them again, or that their friends will tolerate them again. And I just love working with and helping people who have come out and need that extra little information, that extra little insight of how to get going again after those rather abusive years in various closed cultic groups. After saying all these dire things that people have to deal with when they come out of cults, I would like the viewers to know that almost everybody that I know, the great, great majority, have had at least moderate to real good success getting their lives going again. So yes, there is life after the cult.